God of heaven who doeth all things well, who saw fit one more time that we're able to come together on this day in this place with the express purpose of worshiping him in spirit and in truth. And for that, brothers and sisters, you and I ought to be eternally grateful.
Yes.
God is good all the time.
All the time.
And all the time, God is good. God is good even when the snow falls.
Yes, right.
Even when you're tired of shoveling.
Yes.
God is still good. Amen.
Yes.
He woke us up this morning, guided us on our way so that we're able to make it to this place to give him the praise, the honor, and the glory in which he is sure enough due. The psalmist records in Psalm 34 in verse number 1, he said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. The psalmist also recorded in verse number 3, the Bible says, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. And in verse number 8 of that same text, the Bible says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. He's better than camel soup, y'all. The God I serve, he's showing up. He's showing up good. Amen. I didn't run up those stairs like I normally did because those young people wore me out yesterday. Didn't spring out of the bed like I used to. Got up a little bit slower. But God is good in spite of the aches and pains. Thank God for being gay. I'll get that on the way home. Thank God for Sister Newton. I got a personal nurse. I gone ahead, praise the Lord. God is good. As Brother Stewart mentioned, we had a ball on yesterday. I tell you, we had a great time in the Lord. I don't know if the kids were more excited about the Hall of Fame or just playing basketball downstairs. But we had a great time all in all. We appreciate those volunteers who drove up as well as chaperone. And it looks like the kids had a great time, boys and girls. And I tell you, it took about almost 3 hours to get back on yesterday. They had shut down part of the highway, 25 car pileups, and we had to keep looking for different ways to navigate around, and everything went well. Appreciate Brother Green. I was riding in his car, so I had some extra prayers for Brother Green. And then Brother Stewart, he had that van. You know, I tell you, it's dangerous out there. I ain't used to all this on the highway. I was talking to Brother Graham. I said, do people drive to work in this kind of stuff?
Yeah. Yeah.
See, that's exactly what he said. Yeah. I kept saying, honey, you see this road?
Yeah.
I said, people supposed to be off the road, not drive anywhere. But I guess that's the adjustment that we have to make. And I appreciate Brother Hurd. He's in his little car. He's riding, leading the pack. Leading the pack. Praise God. Sister Newton, she told me, just check on it. Check. NJ was riding with Brother Hurd. She had to make sure her prized possession was all right. I said, don't worry about it. You know how many questions NJ has. He going to talk to her today. He going to stay up. So it was just a great time in the Lord. We look forward to more events of the like to continue the fellowship one with another. Due to the weather on today, we're going to push back our vision, part of our service that we were going to do concluding today's message. Next week, we want everybody to hear what we have, and we will make preparations on next week to go over the vision that we've outlined for the congregation. We've been working the men together and outlining the things we need to do to chart the course forward. One more week won't hurt us. Believe me, I'm like, snow, stay away, because I was just ready. But God is good. He's all-knowing, and he outlined the weather, so I don't fuss at the weather. God gives the weather.
Yes, he does.
Amen. Yes. Yeah, y'all got a little rest. Y'all normally were up early, so he gave you till 2 o'clock.
Yes.
Get on there today. Amen. Turn our Bibles to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. We're going to begin at verse number 4. I want verse number 4, and we'll read a little bit more of the text that was read into our hearing. Appreciate Brother Diggs starting to shuffle those hymns of praise. Brother Whiteley reading God's word. Brother Stewart taking us through the throne of grace. And our other brothers who will come to assist throughout the service on today. Y'all don't mind reading the word of God, do you? If y'all did, I still wasn't going to read anyway. It's all right. The Bible says in verse number 4, rejoice in the Lord sometimes. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your gentleness or moderation be made known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful or anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with all thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which surpasseth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and your minds through Jesus Christ our Lord. And the Bible says, finally, brother, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, we ought to think on these things. Is that anybody? Yeah. That the things which you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these things do, and the God of peace will be with you. He said, but I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at your last care of me has flourished again, though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state that I'm in to be what? Some of y'all need to underline that. I've learned to be content. He said, I know how to be abased. I know how it is to be in lack. He said, and I know how to be abound. And I know how it is when the cup runneth over. He said, everywhere and in all things, I've learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do some things. I can do all things through Christ, who does what?
Strengthens
me. Nevertheless, you have done well that you have shared in my distress. Now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church had shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. But even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once again for my necessities. Not that I seek a gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Indeed, I have all and abound. I am full, having received from Epaphroditus the things sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God. And my God shall do what?
Supply
some of your needs. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. This morning, I want to speak to you regarding a subject that's going to be a theme for the month of January. We're going to start a series today calling it I Commit, I Commit. I commit, I commit. Some of y'all scared of commitment and everything, brethren, you know, and stuff of that nature, but commitment is what's needed to keep the church going.
Amen.
Commitment is needed to keep your marriage going.
Amen,
amen, somebody?
Amen.
Amen. Commitment is needed to keep your family together.
Amen.
Y'all ain't saying nothing.
Amen.
Commitment is needed almost in every facet of our life. So we're going to be talking about committed. And this afternoon, I already said this morning again. This afternoon, when I want to speak to you from the subject, I commit to get my negative butts out of the way. I commit to get my negative butts out of the way. I know what y'all said. What is he going to do with this? And for those of you who are taking notes out there, we got 3 points for you. Number one, I commit to be positive and prayerful regardless of my circumstances. I commit to be positive and prayerful despite my circumstances. That's from verses 4-7 of the text. And secondly, I commit to hear, learn, and apply the word of God. That's according to verse number 9 of our text. I commit to hear, learn, and apply the word of God. Is that all right?
All right.
And lastly, number 3, I commit to be content with Jesus Christ. I commit to be content with Jesus Christ. Verses 10-13. 1 through 3 one more time. I commit to be positive and prayerful despite my circumstance. Number 2, I commit to hear, learn, and apply the word of God. And number 3, I commit to be content with Jesus Christ. I commit to get my negative buzz out of the way. Before you all get all offended and everything, I'm not talking about B-U-T-T. I'm talking about another buzz that hold us back in many cases. Whenever the new year comes around, people are conditioned to make resolutions. They set out goals and things they're looking to accomplish throughout the year, whether these goals are physical or personal or financial or even health goals. And we ought to have some spiritual goals up in there somewhere. Amen. Some of y'all started back to the gym last week. Amen. And see, it's not all about starting. It's about finishing. But you know, in the commitment that I made, same dynamic. Sometimes we start good, but we don't always finish strong. But every time I stop, I resolve that I'm going to start again. Amen?
Yeah.
And you say, well, I stopped and I didn't. But you got to keep on starting. Keep on starting. And hopefully, we'll be able to stick to it. In order for our goals to be realized, we must first be consistent, have a consistent effort to implement change and discipline needed in order to reach our goals. The bottom line is we must first be committed. Without a committed or made up mind, real change will not be achieved. Can I get an amen through that? There is an enemy that we face every single day, and we call him the devil, that sends our dreams, our goals, and our ambitions to the graveyard. The Bible says something about the devil in 1 Peter 5 and verse number 8, where it says, be sober, be vigilant. Why? Because your adversary, the devil, he walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. I stopped by to tell you this morning, the devil, he got radar on. He got... He's seeking whom he may devour. Those who are vulnerable, those who are just barely hanging on by a thread, the devil is looking to take you out. Well, let me tell you something else about the devil. The devil, Satan has infused a word into our vocabulary. Is that his stomach? And that word used in a negative vein is called but. You said, brother, what's the big thing about but? The word but is defined as a reservation or an objection. But has ruined dreams. It has ruined relationships. It has even had some of our hopes. Today is a new day. This year is a new year. And our decision, our approach ought to be positive rather than negative. I stop by to tell you, the devil, brethren, will tell you that you can, but I stop by to tell you we serve a God that tells us that we can. But see, the choice is going to be, who is it that you're going to believe?
Yes.
See, the devil, he's slick and he's crafty. He'll use one word that will change the dynamic of everything.
Amen.
You remember when he slithered up to Eve in Genesis chapter 3?
Yes.
He said, for God didn't say, he told him from the beginning, he said, if ye take from the fruit of the tree that's in the midst of the garden, ye shall surely die. But then the devil said, he said, you will not surely die. All he did was inserted one word that changed everything. And I stop by to tell you, if you're not careful, we can allow that word but to dismantle where we're going in the future. But you and I need to develop a resolve in our minds, and we need to commit and be prayerful even despite our circumstances. One of my favorite letters and epistles that the Apostle Paul wrote is the Philippian letter. Because we've got to understand the backdrop and the disposition and Paul in his writing. He's writing from a Roman prison. He's writing, he's locked up, and he's brought up on some trumped up charges. And yet he has in his mind, he said, let me pin some things that will encourage some saints who's been ministering even unto me. He had a joyful disposition even in the midst of some difficult circumstances that he was going through. Amen?
Amen.
Some of us, if I ain't happy, ain't nobody gonna be happy. If ain't peace in my place, it ain't gonna be no peace in your place. Y'all know those people?
Yeah.
All right, I'm just saying. I was about to tell you, Paul had a great love for this group of saints, and he wrote to encourage them to stay focused on the goal and to keep Christ first in everything. And if you begin to read at the beginning of the chapter in verse number 4, Paul outlines some saints. He tells about Euodia and Syntyche, who were faithful sisters in the body of Jesus Christ. But there was some stuff going on with Euodia and Syntyche. They weren't laboring in love like they used to. There were some issues going on among these sisters. And Paul's recommendation to the saints and to the brethren, he said, help those women. He said, look, they were faithful at one time, but now their mindset is off. He says in verse number 2 of chapter 4, he said, I implore Euodia and Syntyche to be of the same mind. Amen, somebody. Jim Street, in order for us to go to higher heights, we got to be on the same mind. You can't have this side going one way and this side going the other way and expect us to be pleasing to God. Amen. No, ma'am and no, sir. Yes. He said, I urge you in verse number 3. I urge you also, true companion, to help these women who labor with me in the gospel with Clement also and the rest of my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. I know there's a thing going on between them, but help them to keep their focus on Christ. Yes. And see, you know, that's the devil's job. He's the key distractor. He's always keeping something going on.
Yes, yes.
When the church is finally getting in the right direction, we're getting the wind beneath our wings. We got a focus, a goal, and an aim. It's his job to stir some stuff up.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's too quiet in here.
Yeah.
We ain't had a fight in a while.
Yeah.
Hey, when a fight break out of here, I know how to fight too. And we will beat the devil out of here. Hey, but this is the Lord's house.
Yeah.
There's no fighting, no shouting, no yelling. No, not in the Lord's house.
Amen.
You might do that in your house, but not the Lord's house.
All right.
Amen. We got to do things the Lord's way. So that was Paul's admonishment to the church in Philippi. He said, I know these sisters got a disagreement between one another, but help them to keep their focus on Jesus.
Yeah.
Paul wrote telling them to work to assist those sisters. And you say, well, why did Paul say this? Because Paul knew that what we now know, that when people are divided and issue-oriented, there is very little done for the cause of Christ.
Yes,
see, I can't worship properly because I remember what they said to me.
Yes,
I remember what she did. I remember what she didn't pay back. I remember, y'all know how some of y'all do, you can't even hear the song, Oh, How I Love Jesus. I surrender all. You ain't surrendering all. You still got some rocks in your pocket. Amen. So I'm trying to help you.
Right.
We got to be who God wants us to be.
Amen.
As many of us know, advancing the cause of Christ was priority number one for the Apostle Paul. And if it was priority number one for Jesus who came to seek and to save the lost, and if it was priority number one to the Apostle Paul who planted churches all over the known world, it ought to be priority number one to us.
Amen?
Amen. You got to get your butt out of the way. I would evangelize Brother Newton, but our negative butts can hold us back. Your negative butts can hinder your relationship even with God. Friends and neighbors, we have to become butt killers. Not that kind of butt. Now, we got to be butt killers. Those things that hold us back from moving forward. The word butt alters and prevents progress. And if we're going to advance in our lives and even as a church, we've got to put these butts to death.
Yeah.
I'm no longer going to continue to live in what I think I can't do. I'm going to begin to walk in what God said I can do.
Amen.
Oh, I'm going somewhere. I'm going. I can't wait to get to heaven. I will come to the church. Look, let me say something. I will come to the church more, Brother Newton, but. I would be more kind to people, but I would forgive, but I would give more. There's a whole lot of buts there, but I used to be more involved, but I would serve, but I would work in this ministry, but he or she, but I wouldn't obey my parents, young people, but I would be more faithful, but I would lose weight, but I would eat better.
Well,
y'all preaching this thing. I would go back to college, but I would step out and start my own business. People have been telling me for a long time, I would do it, but do you now begin to realize that your butts hold you back? They hinder you from where you could be, and they keep you where you're disgruntled and discouraged at? I know some people, they got all the potential in the world. If they only realize the potential they have, they wouldn't be stuck where they are. Are you hearing this thing? In order for the church to move, in order for you to move personally as an individual, you can't continue to live on the I can't. You have to begin to believe in the I can. I told you, but stop us from progressing. It's time to leave your butts in the past, leave them in 2016, and embrace a positive change and move forward, forward, forward. That's my focus. I'm not going to get caught up in that side issue, because if it's not about moving us forward, I'm going to leave it alone.
Amen.
Amen, somebody? You got people, let me tell you something, you got to tell people every now and again, they keep drama going on all the time. See, I've learned to check drama-filled people, and they go the other way. Well, he ain't trying to hear that. You let them know, they'll stop dumping their garbage at your house.
All right.
Amen, somebody?
Amen.
They say, you've been talking negative for 5 minutes. You going to turn it around? No. All right, well, I'll talk to you later then. Amen, somebody?
Yeah.
Well, I can't call him. I'm just saying, okay, I've been hearing you complain. Let's talk about a solution.
Yeah.
Amen? Because if we ain't talking about a solution, if you ain't careful, this is going to turn into gossip in just about a minute.
Okay.
I'm just saying. See, if you're trying to move forward, let me see. Drama-filled people, they'll keep drama in your life.
Amen.
You got to tell them. Sometimes part of you want to hear it, but you got to tell them because you know it ain't good for you. I don't even want to hear it. You know what they said about you, girl? I just don't pray for them. Amen. Amen. Because sometimes just to get you up, what you going to do? They just sitting on the sideline. Here you going back and forth with other eating popcorn. Oh, girl, let me tell you what. You know, that's what people would do.
Yeah.
If you're not careful.
Amen.
And I told you before, you can't please people.
Amen.
Trying to please people will make you go crazy.
Yeah.
And those same people will talk about you go on crazy. Now look at it. Go on crazy. You can't please people. You need to listen to me. You say, I like that preacher. He tell it like he did until I start talking about something you dealing with. I can't stand. Crucify him. Crucify. Then I got to go out the back door. I used to be able to walk in the front door. That's what Paul told one of the churches. He said at one time, look, I was ministering to you. I would have plucked out, y'all would have plucked out one of your eyes and gave it to you. He said, but now do I become your enemy? Because I tell you the truth. What kind of relationship is that? The Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs, a friend loves at all times. The best friends you have, they'll tell you the truth about you. You were wrong about that. You need to apologize. They'll tell you when you're right. They tell you when you're wrong. See, if everybody does, look, they pacify your bad behavior, they're really not your friends. They might be scared of you, but they don't mean you any good. I don't know how y'all got it. Let me get back to it. Butts. Stops us from progressing. We need to leave it in the past. Paul, the inmate, tells the Philippian Christians to rejoice in the Lord all the time.
Yeah.
Same perspective that I talk about in Psalm 34:1. He said, the psalmist said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. What are you saying, psalmist? In the good times, I'm going to bless the Lord. Even in those difficult, dismal times when I don't know up from down, in to out, I'm still going to bless the Lord because he's worthy to be praised. Paul, sitting in a jail cell in Rome in some unsanitary condition, he begins to pen a letter writing to encourage some saints who's not in prison. He says, saints, let me tell you something. He's telling them to rejoice while he's locked up. He's telling them to rejoice while he's not free. Rejoice where? In the Lord. We rejoice in other things. We rejoice in it's all day Sunday football. We rejoice all day Saturday for Monday night football. We rejoice in other stuff, but we ought to be rejoicing in the Lord. You say, ain't nothing going good in this world. Every time I turn on the television, it's a shooting and the kids and this and that. And I tell you, man, if you watch the news, you'd be scared to come outside. We say, well, what am I going to read? You ought to rejoice in the Lord. God is still good. In spite of everything might not be going right in your life. That was the perspective. That was the disposition. Rejoice in the Lord with always. And then he said, in case y'all forgot, and again, I say rejoice. But every now and again, we need some reminding. He said, let your moderation, let your gentleness be made known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. And then he says something. He says, be careful for nothing. That word careful there in the Greek is our English word anxious. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving in your heart. Let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and your minds through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's what the book says. Was Paul rejoicing in his locked up situation? He sure enough was. That's the thing that prompted him to write and encourage the church. Paul said that we have to be positive and have a joyful disposition regardless of the ups and the downs in this life. We glorify Christ when we bless his name even when we're going through a difficult time. Paul says in verse 6, not to be anxious or worry. See, the word careful in the text comes from a Greek word which means, let me say something, it means to be pulled in different directions at the same time. You say, help me with the word picture for the new. Well, on one hand, our hope is pulling us in one direction. But then, in the other direction, our fears are pulling us in another direction. And I stop by to say is sometimes that pull goes on all at the same time. And eventually you become pulled apart. The old English root from which we get our word worry means to strangle. If you've ever really worried about a situation or a person or a circumstance, you can relate to this strangling concept. Paul knew all too well the everyday challenges for believers, and he wanted them to encourage them not to worry, but to give their cares and the supplications to a God that cares about them. That's why the Bible says in 1 Peter 5 and verse number 7, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Y'all hear this thing? He said, don't be anxious about anything, but pray about everything. That's the remedy. He said, don't you worry. You remember that song years ago? Don't you worry. Be. Huh? But some Christians I know, they're the saddest people I've ever met. I'm scared to shake their hand. I think it's going to rub off on me. I'm sorry. That was bad, bad preaching. Bad preaching. Huh? Oh, say rejoice. You say, well, it just ain't no peace in my life. But the question becomes, have I applied what God has said?
All right.
See, that's a remedy in order to get the peace of others. He says, don't worry about anything, but pray about everything. Yeah. He said, prayer, look, it's a peace with thanksgiving. Amen, somebody? Yeah. Look, you ought to have some thankful prayers every now and again.
Amen.
Some of your prayers is nothing to him what he's done.
Yes.
Sometimes all we do is ask it, and we don't say thanks. But the remedy is, he said, with supplication and prayers, with thanksgiving in your heart, he said, let your requests be made known unto who?
God
and the what? Peace of God. Huh? which passeth all understanding. Look, it shall keep our hearts and our minds through Jesus Christ our Lord. There is no peace if I haven't taken it to God. He said, well, I told my boyfriend Tyrone. Tyrone ain't got all the answers. Amen. He got to give his problem to somebody else. Ain't that somebody? Amen. He knows Tyrone to hear on this. But you know what I'm saying? We take our problems to everybody. Well, I told the girls at work about it. I told them and they said this. And if it was them. And God, and look, if you want true peace, you got to do what God said.
Right.
Have you taken it to God? And you know what? That ought to be the first place we go. But sometimes if we just judgment day honest, when nothing else works, try God.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, the sad part, that's the disposition of the child of God. He said, go to me first. You want the peace that passes all understanding? Obey me. Y'all hearing this thing?
Yeah.
We need to make up in our minds this year that we are going to be more positive and prayerful about the situation before we complain about the situation.
Amen.
Amen. I told you before. Amen. Somebody, look. It's easier to complain than it is to change. God is tired of you murmuring, and everybody around you, they sick of it. They might just be scared to tell you. They sick and tired of you complaining too. If you really want to change, you can change. If you really want to change, you can change. Huh? But it starts in the mind. I told you, you know, sometimes we don't change because we're not hurting bad enough.
Yes.
I've told you the story before about the insurance salesman who was selling insurance, and he was going to, you remember years ago, they used to do the door-to-door sales, and you give them that dollars, and you were hoping you had a policy, you give it to the insurance man, you don't know where you put that money at. But the reality was, he went door-to-door sales, and he went to one of his friends, and he was an old man. He was sitting in a rocking chair, and he had a straw hat, and he had a piece of straw hanging out his mouth. But he had this dog sitting next to him, and Brother Jones, that dog, man, that dog was moaning the whole time he was there. That dog, and he was just trying to get the sale, so he was trying to act like he didn't hear it, even though he was hearing it. But then he went to the next door neighbor's house. So he went in the house, and after he finished, he heard the dog still moaning down the street. He said, man, I got to go back and have to, you know, sir, I noticed when I was here and we made this transaction regarding yours, I noticed the dog was in pain. I'm trying to figure out why is it that he keeps moaning. He said, I know why he's moaning. He said, you do? He said, yeah. He said, he's just sitting on a nail, that's all. He said, sitting on a nail? Well, why didn't he get up and move? You know what the old man said? He said, he's not hurt bad enough. Because if you hurt him bad enough, you'll get up and move. Amen, somebody? I'm tired. I can't fit my clothes right. I had the same conversation to myself. You know what I came to realize when I apply this man's circumstance to myself? You ain't hurting bad enough. Huh? It's easier for you to complain than it is to change.
Amen. Yeah.
We got to first make up in our minds. Now, I'm not going to allow but to continue to hinder me or to hold me back. You got to make up in your mind that you're going to be more positive and prayerful about situations.
Amen.
Rather than complaining, first thing I ask, have you prayed about it? No. Well, no, not yet. I'm just saying I'm going to. No, we got to pray. We got to do what the Bible says. Amen. If I want God's peaceful results, I've got to do what God said. In verse 8, he tells us what to focus on, which is a huge contrast to the things of this world. And notice this is also connected to the remedy for peace. He told us how to establish the peace. He said, look, I got to take it to God. But then the instruction is also what we ought to focus on. Well, what am I supposed to focus on, preacher? I'm so glad you asked. In verse number 8, of the text in which we read, the Bible tells us, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's any praise, think on these things. Is that in your Bible?
Yeah.
Let me tell you, he tells us what to focus on, which is a huge contrast to what the world wants us to focus on. We should focus on the things that are true. Well, what's true in this world, Brother Newton? Well, God's word is true. The Bible says, John 17, verse number 17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is true. Well, the things that are honest. So you're focusing on those things that are honest, those things that are just. Look, which means worthy of respect in the things that are right. He said, whatsoever is pure, whatsoever things is lovely, whatsoever things are a good report. Not the gossip magazines. Amen, somebody. Not the tabloid reports. Amen, somebody. He said, what's virtuous or righteous or praiseworthy, that's what you need to set your mind and your focus on. But see, let me tell you something. If your mind's not set on these things, you'll be living in turmoil. You'll be a child of God and live like there's no peace at all. Because your mind's not set on the right thing. That's why the Bible still says in Colossians chapter 3 and verse number 2, set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. He said, look, if it's in order for me to continue to be a spiritual person, I got to set my mind on spiritual things. Yes. Amen? Amen? This is not the place to come and go to sleep.
All right.
This is the place to come to get spiritual instruction. I got to set my mind. I got to come with a different disposition. My disposition is not, all right, now I want to come to church. I can't wait till we get out of here. Let me tell you something. If you keep coming with that mentality, you will continue to come and leave with nothing, and you will not grow. And guess what? You can't blame nobody. Y'all said it, not me. When we look at the lives of other Christians, we should be able to look to one another as examples. Amen? Because the world is all twisted up. But we ought to be able to look to one another for some encouragement. So we ought to be able to say in our minds that this year I'm going to commit to be more positive and prayerful despite my situation or my circumstance. And we ought to encourage one another to do the same. You know complaining people, don't you? You know them. Ask them, did you pray about it? Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's take it to God. Amen. And guess what? You keep doing that every time, they're going to stop bringing that complaining to you. Let's go to God about it. Because he's the one that can really do something. Sometimes they need a listening ear. But you know those who got a complaining disposition. Let me tell you, God, baby girl, honey child, the only one who can really fix it is God. Let's give it to him. Let's give it to him. And secondly, we got to commit to hear, learn, and apply the word of God. Look what Paul said in verse number 9 of the text. The Bible says, Paul told the Philippians, he said, the things in which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, do these things. He said that if you do, the God of peace will be what?
With you. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Paul urged the Philippians to hold on to the things that he taught them and to follow his example. Look, if they did that, the promise was that God, the peace of God would be with them. There's no greater feeling to hear the word, to understand the word, to begin to apply the word, and you see growth in your own life.
Amen.
That's a powerful thing.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
Look, it is even better when others can see the light of Christ in your own life.
Amen.
Because it's our job to light up, to be the best examples that we can be. Matthew 5:16, let your light so shine before men so that they can see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. We need to commit in 2017 to practice what we preach. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
If we look at James 1:21 through about verse number 26, the instruction to James and to the other believers, he said, look, don't be just hearers of the word, but doers as well. He said, don't be like that person who looks into a mirror and they prep it and press it in the mirror. He said, and then they walk away and they forget what manner of man that he is. He said, don't be a forgetful hearer, but be a doer of the word.
Yes.
Look, let me tell you something. I value my time, and I believe you do too. It's either this thing is real or it's not. Why are you going to come? Why are you going to shovel through snow? Why are you going to get up early? Why are you going to come and see instruction after instruction if you're not going to apply this stuff? Let me tell you something. It's a waste of time. He said, well, he messing with his paycheck. But look, let me tell you something. It's bigger than that. That's real. Because what did Jesus say? Matthew 7, verse number 21. He said, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, He said, look, the concept that just me, he said, look, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. What you saying, Jesus? Just because you profess to know me, don't mean you go to heaven. Look, he says, but those who do the will of my Father which is in heaven. If we not applying what we learn it, we're wasting our time. We're wasting our time. And guess what? Our Christianity is not real to those who are out in the world.
All right.
They know us to be one way, and we do another. You just say you go to church. And guess what? It has no impact on them.
Yeah.
Because they don't see the Christian example in your life. We got to make a difference. 27, I'm going to be different. I'm not going to, you know, I will be faithful. I would serve. I would do this. I would. But. What you going to tell God in the judgment? What you going to tell God in the judgment? I tell you, you tell God that at the judgment, you're going to hear some words you don't want to hear. Depart from me.
That's right.
Huh?
That's right.
He worketh of iniquity. He said, I never.
All right.
We will please God as a church if we begin to practice the message that we carry. Let us love in 2017 like we never loved before. Amen?
Amen.
Why only get one amen on that?
Amen.
We need some love up in this church. We need some more love. Amen. Every church I've been to, we can love a little more.
Yes.
Amen, somebody. I can love a little more. You can love a little more. Let me say, let's make up in our mind. This year I'm gonna love like I never loved before.
Amen.
Let us serve this year like we never served before.
Yes.
You say, well, Jimmy, we used to serve. Let me tell you something. Serve in a way like you never served before.
Yes.
Church will be growing. Better. The church will be greater. Look, we got to make up in our mind. Look, let us give our time and our talents and our money. Yes, I did say it. Like we've never done before.
All right.
Why? Because it all belongs to God anyway.
That's right.
That talent, huh? That time. You talk about your time. You only control time. God does. This is the day that the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. Well, who gives the day? God does. Well, what is the day? Ain't nothing but another microcosm of time.
Yeah.
Who owns time? God does.
Yes, he does.
That money you got, who do you think gave you the ability to work that job?
That's right.
You need strength. You need wisdom. You need mental retention in order to be able to keep it.
Yes.
You don't give it to yourself. God is the one who sustains you. Let me give like I've never given before. Let us pray for one another like we've never done before.
Okay.
Oh, listen, man, people need to know this is a praying church.
All right.
So on so deep. Let us reach God in heaven. Let us pray, constantly pray for one another.
Yeah.
You know what he said? When you're mad for somebody, the scripture runs, pray for them.
Yeah.
Pray for them that despitefully use. And that's what the Bible said. They're always supposed to apply what the Bible said.
Yeah.
Don't be looking at me cross-eyed. I'm just saying what the Bible. Let us forgive this year. Like we never forgiven before. Y'all scared out.
All right.
I erased it before I wrote it, but then I said, well. But you know what? In order for us to be sustained, in order for us to continue to have a relationship, we got to forgive anyway.
Amen.
And guess what? You got to learn to forgive quickly. The longer you hold on to it, it's the harder to release it.
Yeah.
That's right.
Huh? I've learned, Brother Pullen, to forgive people and give them to God.
Amen. Right.
Because see, what you have to learn, let me tell you, in your maturity as a child of God, every evil disposition, every wrong thing that a person's done to you, guess who saw it?
God.
Amen. He knows. The Bible still says vengeance is his.
Right.
He's going to repay, says the Lord. He said, I feel like I'm letting them off the hook. God saw it. God gonna deal with it. You ain't gotta put it on Facebook. You ain't gotta send a mass tweet out. You ain't gotta do all that. God knows about it. You ought to forgive like you've never forgiven before.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. Let us exhibit joy this year. Like we've never exhibited joy before. People, man, these are happy people. I don't know what's wrong with them. They got some Jesus juice in them.
All right.
Amen. The fruit of the Spirit.
Yes.
You ain't going to find Jesus juice nowhere. That just kind of came in there. But you want people need to know you got some Jesus in you.
Yes.
And you got the fruit of the Spirit in you, don't you?
Amen.
Somebody just woke up on Jesus. You remember that? Or that the grocery store? No, no, no. Galatians 5:22-23. Look, he said, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, patience, meekness, faith." He said, "Look, against us there is no law." He said, "Look, these things we ought to exhibit to the world." Look, these are identifiers that we truly belong to God.
Yeah.
You can say, "I'm a member that you hate the Church of Christ," but if you mean and nasty, people don't see that.
Yeah.
I know the Church of Christ is on the sign, but the question to me now, can people see the Christ? Be about this now. Take folks see the Christ in you like they've never seen. If you see the Christ in you like they've never seen it before, man, you're able to impact lives like you've never impacted lives before. Are you
understanding?
Yeah. We ought to thank God for when He presents us with new opportunities to serve Him.
Yeah.
Because we serve the Son of the Lord. That's our job. That's all. Serve one another, serve and commit in love. We got to let love lead. Amen?
Yeah.
He said, "Lord, I ain't going to let the past cripple me no more.
Yeah.
I ain't going to let all them but get in the way anymore." Right. You need, let me tell you something. You need to let your negative butts out of the way. You got to commit to get them out the way.
Yeah.
Because guess what? That hinders me from serving God the way I ought to. Stop using it as a crutch.
Yeah.
Somebody need to say it. Amen?
He's
what? Well, they were wrong. I know they were wrong. But you going to let that stop you from going to heaven? Huh?
Yeah.
They need to say, "I'm sorry." I know they do. I know they do. But let me tell you something. You'll put your life on hold waiting for people to do what they already should do. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Do your part. Love God and give them to God.
Yeah.
Keep serving.
Yeah.
Preach the message longer. Look, shake it off and keep serving the Lord. That's what you got to do. God knows. Give it to Him. Give it to Him. And lastly, we've got to commit to be content with Jesus. Paul talks about learning contentment. He said, whatever situation you find yourself in, therewith to be content. Contentment doesn't mean complacency. The Greek word means self-sufficient. And it was a favorite word of the Stoic philosophers, but the Christian is not sufficient in himself. He's sufficient in Christ because Christ lives in him.
Yes.
He's the one who actually makes us adequate. In verse 13, one of our most favorite verses, Philippians 4:13, the Bible says, "I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me."
Yes,
and my grandma, I tell you, I was going out the house, I'm telling you, from 5 years old, I can't. Recite it before you leave out the house. But grandma, I said it yesterday. I can do all things through Christ. I'm saying on a frown on my face. Through Christ is strengthened. And grandma, look, she would use it out of context sometimes. Because if you want to be an astronaut, you can be an astronaut. She would just throw this in the text. But when I come to learn what Paul is saying, in essence, and in verse number 13, one of the most popularly quoted scriptures throughout the Bible, "I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me." Look, one of the most powerful verses in the Bible. The Living Bible says, "I can do everything God asks me to with the help of Christ who strengthens me."
Yeah.
I'm here to tell you today that Jesus Christ is our power source. The devil may tell you that you can, but I stop by to tell you, we serve a God that tells us that we can. This scripture is simply pointing out that God gives us the ability and power to perform any and everything He commands us to do.
Yes.
What you're saying, preacher? Put some color on it. Well, He commands us to forgive.
Uh-huh.
You by yourself, separate and apart from Christ, you got a limitation.
Yeah.
But when you plug into the right power source, Jesus, He will enable you to do some things that you couldn't naturally do on your own. Y'all hearing this thing? Stop talking about what you can't do when He's already given us all things, look, that we need to obey Him. I can't, brother. I'm sorry. I can't. Let me tell you something. As long as you keep saying you can't, you won't. But let me tell you something. Let me tell you, you didn't get that "I can't" from God. Huh? Newsflash, you never read that in the scripture. Look, you didn't get the I can't from God. You got that from you. Huh? God tells us that we can. You say, well, he commands us to begin. I know it may be hard, but we see what Christ, look, giving us, he gives us the ability to be able to do it. He tells us to love. Yeah. Amen. He said, I mean, look, people can make this difficult, but through Christ, you can.
Amen.
He tells us to give. That may be tough, because some of us are a little stingy.
Amen.
But with Christ, you can.
Amen.
Give him my time. My time is precious. So is everybody else's. Give him my talents. You know my status. You know what I know you still came from the dust of the ground.
Right.
And when you die, that's when you're going again. Your body's going.
Amen.
Hey, that's why the Bible still said, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think.
Yeah.
But to think soberly and righteously. You got to understand who you are in the cosmos of it all.
Yeah.
Man, God is everything. I'm just grateful that, look, that he chooses to use us because he doesn't have to.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. The world doesn't want us to be content. It wants us to be discontent and to seek another option other than Christ.
Yes.
I stop by to tell you today that Jesus Christ, he's everything you need and more.
Amen.
I think I'll say it again.
Yes.
Jesus Christ, he's everything you need and more.
Amen.
As we go throughout this year and we run into a lot of those little buts that get in our way, we've got to remember that through Christ I can.
Yes.
Through Christ I can.
Yes.
When you get in the way, I don't feel like it. That's really what it all feels. That's really what we all say. It's not that you can't. You don't feel like it. Oh, I don't want to. But you've still got to remember, through Christ I can.
Yes.
You can have joy.
No.
You can smile. You can forgive. You can help. You can serve. Through Christ, you can.
Amen.
And guess what? I'm a preacher to you just like you can.
Right.
Why? Because the script, Bible tells us that you can. But sometimes I just got to work on you want to. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
But Christ said you can, and I'm not going to treat you like you can. Amen, somebody. Well, what can I do through Christ? Well, you can accomplish things you've never accomplished before.
Amen.
You can conquer whatever the thing it is in life that you're facing.
Yeah.
If you're here today and you're ready for a change, there's no better time to start your journey than right now.
Amen.
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 Amen. There's no better day than today. I recommend that you and I, we need to make the commitment. I commit to get my negative butts out of the way. They hinder me in my spiritual relationships. They hinder me in my physical relationships. They hinder me. They hinder me financially. I can't say that much. Guess what? You see what I can't do? I would say, but do you see how all these butts and holding on to them, how they affect our living? God doesn't want you to grow stunted.
Amen.
He wants you to thrive spiritually. He said, look, believe in him. Trust in his word.
Yeah.
And you will be able to do. He will enable us to do things that we've never done. He will enable us to go places that we've never gone.
Yeah.
But the key has to be,
yeah,
are you going to trust him?
Well,
my marriage, it would get better, but, you know, she, but he,
yes.
What about God?
Okay.
All right.
Amen.
Through God, we can put this thing back together.
Yes.
Yes. Amen?
Amen.
I ain't resting on the weekends.
Mm-hmm.
I ain't resting on the weekends. I have, One of my good friends in ministry, Brother John Wilkie, he's the minister of the Edgewood Church of Christ in Baltimore. Before I had set out to do full-time ministry, we were having a conversation. And I've been toying with the idea for a long time. And he said, man, look, you comfortable working them two jobs, killing yourself. Yeah, you always complain, man, it's too much. Man, it's too much. Why don't you step out on faith? One day we were having a conversation. Eric, he said to me, man, I want to come through that phone line. He said, you know what, dude? You know what your problem is? You scared. If you know who I am. So what you say? You scared. You heard it. You better be glad you're a Baltimore. You scared. And guess what? He's right. You scared to leave that comfortable job. Come on. You said, you comfortable. You doing it, but ain't what you want to do. Amen. And sometimes we got, see, sometimes you need somebody to challenge you.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. I would say a whole lot of stuff. I wouldn't do full-time ministry, but you know how churches are. Yeah. You know how people are.
Yeah.
They lay you the first year or the first month. He said, well, who are you trusting in? Who that God you preach about every week? Do you believe it or not? Sometimes you got to wrestle with the truth. Huh? But then when you do, you better for it.
Amen.
And I love this brother still till the day.
Amen.
And we had that conversation. He said, you're growing up. You ain't scared no more. and then after I was so hot, I got a phone. Look, you know I talked to Wilkie today. You know what he said to me? She said, he did? I don't even know why I called you. But you know, sometimes, look, when you stepping out into an area, it's scary sometimes. It's scary. Huh? And see, and make this decision, it's the biggest decision I make, because it doesn't just affect me, it's I got kids.
Yeah.
And the worst time to leave is when they're in high school. That's tough.
Yeah.
And then you're still not sure. Well, God's needing you. All right, if I'm a child, I'm going to step out. And let me tell you something. And when I got stuck, I'm going to expect you to step out too. We got to trust them.
Yeah.
I don't know how this thing going to work, but I'm hoping for the best. But you know, I'm going to do my part.
Yeah.
I'm going to do my part.
Yeah.
You know how people. You know how, you know, I don't know how to get there to get phone call. You already know the Maryland phone call. You know how people are. You always have dissenting voices.
Yeah,
no, it's snow up there. That's why they got coats and gloves. Shovels and stuff like that. Huh? Go to another, man, it's hot out there. You know, that will always be.
Yeah.
And see, sometimes I got to use me to help you. There's things that we're afraid. I'm afraid of going back to school. But you know that's what you need. So look, you can move to the next level.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's some jobs that you want, you know you can do, that you can't even apply for because you don't have a degree.
Amen.
Rather than keep frustrated, I keep training these people and they're taking my position. And sometimes it's only up to you to do something about it.
That's right.
How am I going to get through with the help of God? Just like everything else. How am I going to raise these kids in this crazy world? With the help of God, like everything else. How are we going to keep this marriage going? How am me and my wife going to get to 15?
Yes.
In August, with the help of God.
Yes.
Just like everything.
Yes.
How are we going to grow this church? And they said, you know the reputation, and you know this, and you know how people, you know, how are we going to? With the help of God.
Yes.
Just like everything else.
Yes.
See, I realize it's not just me.
Right.
I'm just a tool in God's toolbox.
That's right.
So it's not about this one person here, person. Well, if so-and-so don't come to church, and this whole church came in, you don't know God, do you?
Yeah,
right. Huh? Okay, you looked in the Bible, they were always replacements.
Yeah.
Moses died, Joshua, you called. Huh?
Yeah.
God, look, and that's why we never, don't ever get yourself on a precipice. What, nothing to operate without you.
All right.
Come on.
God didn't tell you that. That's a lie you fell into by the devil.
Amen.
And say, man, God will take and use us at his choosing. Mm-hmm. But we just have to open our hearts and minds up to be used by him.
That's right.
Stop being scared.
Mm-hmm.
I had to stop being scared. Especially after I was called down. Lord have mercy. I'm glad it's just me and him on the phone. But what's the concept? I'm here to challenge you. I'm going to challenge you. I already told you I was going to challenge you before I accepted the job.
Yes.
And y'all called me.
Yes. All
right.
So that means you were ready to be challenged.
All right.
Yes. Right.
Well, you said, brother, they were ready to be challenged. I thought another way. Well, I'm stuck now. So let's learn to work, love each other, and keep on going with God.
Praise God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's work together for God. Don't you want this year to be better?
Yes.
Well, guess what? In order for it to be better, you got to play a part.
That's right.
Because look, God's already going to do his.
Oh, yeah.
Many times he's waiting on us.
That's right.
We can't expect the harvest if we don't sow the seed.
That's right.
All right.
That's our job.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? Increase will come.
Oh, yes.
If we do what God says.
Yes. Right.
And that's my job. Help us to focus on what God says. And let's apply what God says.
All right.
Let's not just sit here and come to church and do all this stuff. Look, we got to believe what we're saying.
All right.
Look, that message we carry. Look, when we live those life, people will really begin to believe because they knew you before.
Yes. Right.
They knew when you was out there. They knew. Look, the way, they said, man, this brother, they changed. What happened to him? God. Jesus Christ. You need some of that too.
Yes, sir.
Amen. But see, if you're living in a place and you're unchanged, you can't convert them. Because
mm-hmm.
They're not even sold on that you believe what you believe.
All right.
You half hearted. You come sometimes. You don't believe that stuff. You ain't fake. You ain't committed.
Yes.
You say, man, it's known outside. Where you going? My neighbor, we shall like, y'all, God's been good.
Oh, yes.
He gave us snow, but don't you see that sunshine?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, you're right. Even when it gets tough. Stick to it. Don't always feel right. Stick to it. Look, because God has been faithful to us.
Amen.
If you don't know Jesus in the party, you just come to him. I hear the gospel message. Believe the same. Repenting and trusting in Christ and being baptized for the remission of your sin. Let me tell you something. Oh, hey, without being baptized, you're still in your sin. They got to be washed away.
Yes.
Why not start the year off right?
Yeah.
Look, right with Christ. That's the way to be right. See, you'll fall out of favor with people all the time. They'll love you 1 minute. Then they act like they don't want to speak to you the next minute. That's people.
Yes,
man. But aren't you glad God doesn't treat us like people?
Yes.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
So you need to be right with God today. If you're not a member of the Church of Christ, you're not a member of the body of Christ, why don't you start over today with God? If you're a member of the body, you say, you ain't been committed like you need to be. That when your 2016 was a little shaky. You say, I'm going to verbalize it to the church so they help keep us accountable. See, sometimes we don't want to verbalize nothing because we don't want nobody to keep us accountable. But see, accountability helps us to stay faithful.
Amen.
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 If you just need prayer, you say, I want to be stronger than I've been. I want to be a stronger father, a stronger husband. I want to be a stronger brother in this church. I want to be a stronger sister. I want to be a stronger mom. Whatever capacity in which you serve, we're about to stand and sing the Savior's invitation. We want you to come. We want you to come. We're not rushing. We want you to come. Let us stand. Let us stand. Come on. Come on. Give your life to Jesus Christ today.
6:13, are you watching the book?
6:13.